Hey folks, this is Shock, and we're going to do another exciting Bible study. You guys love these Bible studies. I love doing the Bible study, so the feeling's mutual. And we're going to be reading from the book of John. Now, what we do every time before we do the Bible study, which is going to be here, I like to show you some of the new features here at shockcanal.net. We've redesigned the website to make it easier to navigate. I want to show you, we have our 24-hour chat room right here. You see the globe spinning around, all these little stars, these little bright things blinking. These are live people that are at the website right now. And it looks like you can move the mouse around and it makes the earth move around. Pretty cool. Let's see what else we got here. I know what to show you. The radio show. Check this out. If you click this, Shock Radio on the top right, check this out. Pretty cool, huh? You can listen to our radio shows here. And we have done live radio shows. Some of the most exciting shows are the shows where I take live calls from unbelievers. It's very, very exciting. You never know what's going to happen. So don't forget to click Shock Radio. I've had some famous people on Shock Radio that we've interviewed, so you'll like that. And then, check this out, debates on the top left. Let's click that, or the middle left. Now, these are debates that I've done and debates that I think you will really, really enjoy. It's taking forever to load because there's tons of them on the page, so maybe I shouldn't have clicked debates. But then also there's debates too, right here. And then free audiobooks. There's just tons of things. You got to check this out. So let's get started. And, oh, by the way, let's go back home. If you click this button right here, you'll be in our live chat room right here. This big button right here, you'll be in the live chat room. And if you scroll down here, look, there's 22 people in the chat room right now. You also can click this. So let's get to the Bible study. Now, we're going to be reading from the book of John. And I just think it's awesome that we can read the words that God himself had spoken. Notice what it says here, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So it's awesome. Think about that. God, who has created the universe, who's responsible for you and I even being alive and having the gift of life, you could actually read the things that God has to say to us. I mean, think about that. It doesn't get any more epic than that. So let's go through this. And what we do is we go through the Bible study. I stop along the way and I'll chat with you guys. And, you know, a lot of folks that have never read the Bible, when we do these Bible studies, they go, wow, it's really interesting. And I think the Bible is the most interesting book in the world. It's the number one bestseller, of course, so the world agrees. Here we go. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, notice, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness. Notice it says, and the darkness comprehended it not. Interesting. Now, it says, there was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. Notice it says, John was not the light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. And by the way, We're reading from the book of John, so I might as well tell you about this. The Apostle John wrote the fourth gospel sometime between AD 85 to 90. He says, in order that, quote, you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name, unquote. Now, although John's gospel is a very personal eyewitness account of who Jesus is and what he came to do, John does not identify himself by name. Instead, he consistently describes himself by using some form of the phrase, quote, the disciple whom Jesus loved, unquote. And what you'll find, guys, is John uses very simple language to convey his message, but the truth he presents is a rich and deep truth, as anything in the Bible. Now, while the other three Gospels center on key events in Jesus' life, which you're going to find here with John, he often focuses upon the meaning of those events. Consider the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000, which all four Gospels record. Only John gives us Jesus' message on the bread of life, which follows that miracle. Here, as elsewhere, what you're going to find, guys, is John puts special emphasis on the deity of Jesus. So he reports Jesus' words, quote, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst, unquote. John does not always order his gospel in a chronological way. But instead, what you're going to notice here is he highlights seven miracles that Jesus performed and seven I am statements that the Savior made. In following this plan, John gives us a unique perspective. In fact, what's interesting, when you research it, 90% of the material found in his gospel appears nowhere else. John selected what he did in order to lead his readers to put their faith in Jesus Christ as the Messiah, the Savior of the world. For this reason, the word believe plays a critical role in the Gospel of John. So let's continue. Notice that it talks about Jesus Christ, that was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, interesting, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. So picture this, here you're God, you create the world, and the world rejects you. But notice it says, but as many as received him, to them he gave power to become the sons of God. That's you and I. Even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And this is what I was mentioning earlier, how this is awesome. Notice, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. Where did we hear that from? Remember up here? It says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then you notice here, verse 14, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bare witness of him and cried, saying, this was he of whom I spake. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness have all we received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. No man has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. And this is the record of John. When the Jews sent priests and Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, who art thou? They're asking John, who are you? John confessed and denied not, but confessed, I am not the Christ. And they asked him, what then? Art thou Elijah? And he said, I am not. Art thou that prophet? And he answered, no. Then said they unto him, well then, who art thou, that we may give an answer to them that sent us? What sayest thou of thyself? And this is excellent. He said, "I am the voice of one crying in the wilderness, make straight the way of the Lord, as said the prophet Isaiah." And they which were sent were of the Pharisees. And they asked him, and said unto him, "Why baptizest thou then, if thou be not the Christ?" Notice, they're saying, if you're not Elijah or the prophet or the Christ, then why are you baptizing? And notice what John says. John says, "I baptize with water, but there standeth one among you whom you know not." Now, when you read about John, John basically lived out in the wilderness. He ate locust. You know, he probably had very, very long hair. And when he would say, "Repent," people like me would be, "Yes, sir." You know, this guy was very, very powerful personality, you know. And notice, John was not a respecter of persons. He put God first in his life. And he's talking about Jesus. He says, "He it is who coming after me is preferred before me, whose shoes latchet I'm not worthy to unloose." He's talking about Jesus Christ being so awesome that he's not even worthy to unloose his shoes. That's how awesome Jesus is. "These things were done in Bethabara beyond Jordan, where John was baptizing." Now, picture this. He's talking about Jesus Christ, and as John's baptizing, Jesus Christ approaches. "The next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him and said," so John sees Jesus, and he announces Jesus, "Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. This is he," John said, "of whom I said, after me cometh a man which preferred before me, for he was before me. And I knew him not, but that he should be made manifest to Israel. Therefore am I come baptizing with water." And John bare record, saying, "I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode upon him." There's a lot of folks that will say it was a dove, and not, I don't want to ruin this beautiful moment, but notice it says, it said it was like a dove, so it's not necessarily a dove, but it had the appearance of a dove. "And I knew him not," John says, "but he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizeth with the Holy Ghost." So John was told, when you see the Spirit descend and remain on him, this person, Jesus Christ, that is the person that's going to be baptizing with the Holy Ghost. "And I saw and bear record that this is the Son of God. Again the next day after John stood and two of his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walked," John says again, "behold the Lamb of God. And the two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus. Then Jesus turned and saw them following." So Jesus sees these people following him, and he says unto them, "What are you looking for? What seek ye?" They said unto him, "Rabbi," which is to say, being interpreted, "Master, where dwellest thou?" Like, you know, we want to see where you're staying. And look at this. Jesus, very friendly to them, he saith unto them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he dwelt, and abode with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour. So this is just awesome. They're fellowshipping with God. One of the two which heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first findeth his own brother Simon, and saith unto him, "We have found the Messiah," which is being interpreted, the Christ. And he brought him to Jesus, and when Jesus beheld him, he said, so picture this, they bring him to Jesus, and Jesus says this to him, "Thou art Simon, the son of Jonah, thou shalt be called Cephas," or Cephas, which is by interpretation a stone. So which is a very good compliment that Jesus gives him. Now, the day following, Jesus would go forth into Galilee and findeth Philip, and saith unto him, "Follow me." Now Philip was of Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip findeth Nathanael, and saith unto him, "We have found him." So everyone's starting to come to Jesus Christ here, they're saying this is the Messiah. And so Philip tells Nathanael, says, "We found him, of whom Moses and the law and the prophets did write, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Now, this is what's really interesting. Nazareth was not really well known as some holy, righteous, good, clean, classy area. I would say, let's say Nazareth would be similar to, let me think of an area where I can't offend people. I'm trying to think of an area where, which isn't too good that I don't want to. Well, let's just come up with something. Let's say like a real bad area of Hollywood, okay? And check this out. Nathanael said, after they told him, you know, he's from Nazareth, Nathanael has this little dig here. He goes, "Can there any good thing come out of Nazareth? Like, you got to be kidding me. From Nazareth, can any good come out of Nazareth?" And Philip saith unto him, "Come and see." Now, Nathanael's a good guy, right? Now, watch this. Jesus sees Nathanael coming to him, and he says to Nathanael, so imagine you're Nathanael, right? And you haven't even met Jesus yet, and Jesus gives you this compliment. He says, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no guile," which is a very good compliment. He's saying you're a sincere person. And Nathanael's blown away by this. He says, "Whence knowest thou me?" Like, how do you know me? How do you know me? He's being polite as he's asking Jesus. Says, look what Jesus says. He blows Nathanael's mind here. Jesus answered and said unto him, "Before Philip called thee, when thou wast under the fig tree, I basically saw you." Notice, I saw thee. So Nathanael's like, whoa. He's impressed by this, right? Nathanael answered and saith unto him, "Rabbi, thou art the Son of God. Thou art the King of Israel." Jesus answered and said unto him, like, and this is really cool what Jesus says. He says, "Because I said unto thee, I saw thee under the fig tree, believest thou?" Like, in other words, wow, you believe so easy just because of that. And then Jesus basically says, you haven't seen anything yet. You're going to see some great things. He says, "Because I said unto thee, I saw thee under the fig tree, believest thou? Thou shalt see greater things than these." So he's basically saying, hang on tight, you're going to see some epic stuff. Now, Jesus said unto him, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, hereafter you shall see heaven open, and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." John 2. And the third day there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. And both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. So there's like someone's getting married there. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, "They have no wine." Now notice what Jesus says to Mary, "Woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come." So Mary has this faith in Jesus, and she brings this problem to her, saying, hey, you know, they ran out of wine, we don't have wine. And Jesus is like, my hour hasn't come yet. His mother saith unto the servants, so I could picture Mary there saying, hey, look, you know, whatever he tells you to do, just do it. She has faith in Jesus, right? And there were set there 6 water pots of stone after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. Jesus saith unto them, fill the water pots with water, and they filled them up to the brim. And he saith unto them, draw out now, and bear unto the governor of the feast, and they bear it. When the ruler of the feast, now this is interesting here, we're going to have to spend a little time talking about this. When the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and knew not whence it was, but the servants which drew the water knew, the governor of the feast called the bridegroom, and saith unto him, notice what he says. He says, every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine. When do they put out the good wine? Notice, at the beginning. And when men have well drunk, in other words, when they're kind of feeling it, you know, they've well drunk, and their taste buds are already saturated with the good wine, then that which is worse. In other words, then you put out the cheap stuff. And then, so he compliments this wine. He goes, but thou hast kept the good wine until now. This beginning of miracles did Jesus in Cana of Galilee and manifested forth his glory, and his disciples believed on him. After this, he went down to Capernaum, he and his mother and his brethren and his disciples, and they continued there not many days. And the Jews' Passover was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now, I want to show you what sweet, meek Jesus does here. Sweet, meek, loving Jesus, what he does. And this is why I like doing Bible studies, because I think people have the wrong impression of Jesus, that he was just some type of pushover, or he was just very passive with everything. Notice he was very, very bold and had this zeal for his house, the temple. Look what he does here. Sweet, meek, gentle Jesus, okay? And this, I think, you know, when I was an atheist and I read this, I started to gain more and more respect for Jesus, you know, how awesome he is and how he, well, I'll let the passage read for itself. Watch this. So Jesus goes in the temple, and he found in the temple those that sold oxen and sheep and doves and the changers of money sitting. Now, let's talk about this in case you don't know what we're talking about. What would happen is when you would go do the sacrifice, let's say you were kind of poor, you know, and you had this little dove, you know, and you'd bring it to the temple, but these money changers, what they were doing is, when, let's say you brought in your dove and you'd have this little dove for the sacrifice, they would say, nope, your dove has fleas, for example. Well, no, it doesn't. Yes, it does. You can't use this one. You need to get our dove. Well, how much is your dove? $700, for example. I'm just making an amount so you can see. And they'd be like, man, you know. So they would put these burdens of these sacrifices, and they were turning it into a money-making business. You know, they would try to make you buy their oxen or sheep or doves, right? So Jesus sees this, and he sees the changers of money, and he sees the oxen, the sheep, and the doves. And look what sweet, meek, gentle Jesus does. And when he had made a scourge of small cords, it's basically like a whip he's making, he drove them all out of the temple, and the sheep and the oxen, and he like releases all these animals, and poured out the changers' money and overthrew the tables. He basically goes in and he's cleaning house. His house. And he said unto them that sold the doves, take these things hence, make not my Father's house a house of merchandise. And his disciples remembered that it was written, the zeal of thine house hath eaten me up. So notice he's very zealous for his Father's house, his house. Then answered the Jews and said unto him, what sign showest us, seeing that thou doest these things? Like, you know, you need to show us a sign that gives you the right to do this. Jesus answered and said unto them, destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up. Then said the Jews, 46 years was the temple in the building, and wilt thou rear it up in 3 days? In other words, it took 46 years to build this. How are you going to build it in 3 days if we destroy it? And they're thinking he's talking about the temple, not his body. But notice, but he spake of the temple of his body. When therefore he was risen from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this unto them, and they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had said. Now, when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover and the feast day, many believed in his name when they saw the miracles which he did. But notice this interesting phrase here. But Jesus did not commit himself unto them because he knew all men, and needed not that any should testify of men, for he knew what was in man. Interesting. That's pretty heavy. John 3. Now, this dude Nicodemus is he's really searching for truth. And he's a man of the Pharisees, but the Pharisees had this faction of Pharisees within them that did not like Jesus, jealous, and even they wanted to kill him. But Nicodemus is a cool guy, right? So he doesn't want the other Pharisees to know, obviously, that he wants to talk to Jesus, right? He don't want to have the problems. So notice, the same Nicodemus, he comes to Jesus by night and says unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. In other words, there's no way you can be doing all this unless God's with you. Now, it's interesting, Jesus immediately starts teaching him something. Immediately, Jesus doesn't say, well, thank you, you know, or yes, you're right, or he immediately goes into teaching mode, and he says to him, verily, verily, and by the way, for those of you who've never read scripture, when Jesus says verily, verily, he's basically saying, you can rely on what I'm telling you. This is truth. This is a for sure thing. He says, and this is very important. If you're not saved, you want to read this. As a matter of fact, if I only had 4 minutes of your time, I would read this following these following words, okay? Very, very important. It has eternal consequences to your life and mine. So Jesus says, verily, verily, in other words, this is truth, what I'm telling you, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Now Nicodemus probably like, what? Nicodemus saith unto him, well, how can a man be born when he is old? He's already been born, right? Can he enter the second time into his mother's womb and be born? Jesus answered, look, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born of, look, water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. Now, notice, he says first, except a man be born of water and of the Spirit, which is what? Physical birth and spiritual birth. Because look what the next phrase is. He says, that which is born of flesh is flesh, the water, you know, water birth, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. Marvel not, like, you know, don't be amazed by this or confused. He says, that I say unto you, you must be born again. Notice, it's a requirement. You must be born again. And look what he said in the previous passage. And I mean, guys, if what Jesus is saying is the truth, and I believe it is, this is some serious heavy stuff that has ramifications for your life. So I would strongly suggest you pray about this and take it seriously. He says, I'm telling you, verily, verily, except a man be born of water and the Spirit, what? He cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of spirit is spirit. Marvel not, in other words, don't be so amazed by it that you don't pay attention here. Marvel not that I said unto thee, you must be born again. And then Jesus talks about other things that, like the wind, for example, where you don't know where it came from, you don't know where it's going, but yet watch. He says, the wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but you can't not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. You know how when you see dirt in the wind and stuff, that's not really the wind, that's just debris in the wind, you see. So he's saying, the wind comes and goes, you don't know where it comes from, you don't know where it goes, so is everyone that is born of the Spirit. He says, Nicodemus answered and said unto him, he's like, Jesus is blowing his mind here. Nicodemus says, well, how can these things be? Now, the scripture talks about this, right? But Nicodemus missed it. He missed this part of the scripture. And Jesus even brings this up to him. He says, art thou a master of Israel? Like, you're a teacher of Israel and you don't know these things? Verily, verily, there it is again, guys. I say unto thee, we speak that we do know and testify that we have seen, and you receive not our witness. If I have told you earthly things and you believe not, in other words, if he's telling them you got to be born again and the guy doesn't believe it, how's he even going to be able to grasp heavenly things? He goes, if I have told you earthly things and you believe not, how shall you believe if I tell you heavenly things? And no man hath ascended up to heaven, but notice, but look at it, but he that came down from heaven, this is Jesus is saying that he's the one that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man, which is in heaven. Notice, he refers to Moses lifting up the serpent in the wilderness. Remember when Moses was leading the people out of Egypt and they got bitten by the snakes in the wilderness there in the desert, and God told him to fashion this serpent onto this staff, and as he would hold up the staff with the serpent on it, when the people would look upon it, they would get healed of their snake bites, right? And this is what Jesus is referring to. He's saying, you know, and as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him, notice, should not perish, but have eternal life. It's just the best news in the world. For God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now, these are very important words. Let's go through this together. If what Jesus said is truth, and I know it is, then all of us are under the condemnation already of our sins. But we can escape it because Jesus Christ took our punishment on the cross. He is the propitiation of our sins. And when he died on the cross, he took that punishment. He took the wrath of God upon himself. There is a wrath of God. It's not politically correct to talk about, but it's the truth. There is a wrath of God. God is so holy and just that he will judge sin. That's his nature. But the wrath of God and the mercy of God meets at the cross. You can choose to accept the wrath upon yourself, or you can choose to accept the grace that Jesus Christ has given us. The choice is up to you. For God's sakes, let's choose wisely. Look what Jesus says. I would say this is probably the most heavy words in Scripture, the most important words out of all of Scripture. He says, that whosoever believeth in him, let's read it slow, guys, because it's important, should not perish but have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. How could the world be saved? Because the wrath of God was poured out on Jesus Christ on the cross. But now, what about the people that reject Jesus Christ? That people that want to distance themselves from God, they don't want to have fellowship with God. God gives them what they want. Total separation from him. Look what Jesus says. When you want to distance yourself from God, God gives people what they want. Like I mentioned, total separation. There's a saying that says hell is locked from the inside. The only reason why people are going to go to hell is because they chose to distance themselves from God. They chose to spit in God's face. They chose to reject the salvation. There's a scripture that says, how can we refuse so great a salvation? Watch this. He says, he that believeth on him, is not condemned. So that would be like someone like me that admits I'm a sinner and I believe in Jesus Christ and I put my hope, faith, and trust in his finished work on the cross. Remember when Jesus died, his last words were tetelestai, which is basically, it is finished. So you don't earn your way to heaven. You don't earn it. It is finished. He paid the penalty for our sin. So he that believeth on him is not condemned. Pretty straightforward, right? But he that believeth not is condemned. What's this word say, guys? Already. Is already future tense or is that present tense? That's present right now, isn't it? Already condemned. Why? Why would they be condemned? Well, all sins are forgiven through Jesus Christ. Here's why they're condemned. Because he hath not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. See, it doesn't matter if you and I do less sins than the murderer or the person that's in prison or whatever. One sin is enough. One sin is imperfection. And you and I have both done a lot more than one sin. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is what? Condemned already, like right now. You know, Scripture says the wrath of God abides on the sinful man. Now, you know what kind of boggles my mind is how some people are so angry about this when the solution is right in front of our face. Now, if you're not humble, if we have this pinch of arrogance, then it's going to be very hard for the natural man to confess that they're a sinner and humble themselves. It is humbling. And admit that we're worthy of hell. The natural man doesn't want to do that because you can't have a low self-image of yourself and do that. You won't like the way you feel because you're having to admit the truth that you are a sinner. Scripture says that the gospel is foolishness to the natural man, and the natural man cannot discern it because these things are spiritually discerned. So notice, Jesus says, why people reject him. He even says why. And this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. I guarantee you, the people that don't want to come to Jesus Christ, there's something in their life that they know they're doing is wrong, and they don't want to give it up. You know that as well as I do. And then Jesus says, and this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world and men love darkness rather than light. Why? Well, because their deeds were evil. For everyone that does evil hates the light, neither cometh to the light. Why? Lest his deeds should be reproved. But he that does truth comes to the light, that his deeds may be manifest that they are wrought in God. After these things came Jesus and his disciples into the land of Judea, and there he tarried with them and baptized. And John also was baptizing in Ainon near to Salim, because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized. Later on, John gets cast into prison, but at this time, John was not yet cast into prison. Then there arose a question between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purifying. And they came unto John and said unto him, Rabbi, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, to whom thou bearest witness, behold, the same baptizeth, and all men come to him. John answered and said, "A man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. You yourselves bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but that I am sent before him. He that hath the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom which standeth and heareth him rejoice greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. This my joy therefore is fulfilled." Now notice this, as Jesus is becoming more and more a major person within that area, everyone's starting to follow him, right? And which was John's purpose. And look at the humbleness of John. He says, "He must increase, but I must decrease. He that cometh from above is above all. He that is of the earth is earthly, and speaketh of the earth. He that cometh from heaven is above all. And what he hath seen and heard, that he testifieth, and no man receiveth his testimony. He that received his testimony hath set to his seal that God is true. For he whom God hath sent speaketh the words of God, for God giveth not the Spirit by measure unto him. The Father loveth the Son, and hath given all things into his hand." Now here it is, we're going to end on this scripture here. "He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him." If you're not saved yet, if you're not saved, here's what you do. What you want to do is do what the thief on the cross did, the one that turned to Jesus Christ. If you actually read that, what he did is, number one, he admits that he's a sinner, that we fall short of God's standard. That we fall short of God's standard. And then what he does is he asks Jesus to have mercy on him. And Jesus says, "Truly I say to you, today you'll be with me in paradise." So it's really, really good news. But if you're not saved, then this wrath of God abides on you and I, if we're not saved. I do not know for the life of me why people would not flee the wrath of God. You know, sometimes I'll be talking to my unbelieving friends and they'll say, "Well, I don't believe in hell." Friends, listen closely. Your belief in hell is not a requirement for you to go there. Doesn't matter if you deny it or not. That's not one of the requirements. Falling short of God's standard and being a sinner is the requirement that you and I both meet. So this is serious stuff, guys. Don't allow the stupidity of this world, the political correctness of this world, the arrogance of this world, the stupidity of mankind cause you to go to hell. This is a spiritual moment in your life. What I would do is spend some time away from the TV, away from YouTube, away from the internet, and pray about these things. Remember what John said. This is it. This is for the whole ball game here. This is some serious stuff. Nothing else matters. Don't matter if you are very successful financially. Doesn't matter if you if you're a girl looking for a husband, or a husband looking for a wife, or you're lonely, you need a boyfriend or girlfriend, or you need a good job, you need a good career. All these things are secondary things compared to eternity. Remember when Jesus was saying, he was talking about heaven, and he said it's like a man walking through a field that finds a great treasure, and then he sells everything he has to buy the field because the treasure that's within it is worth more than all his worldly goods. Remember, Jesus says, you know, what can someone give in return for their soul? So let's end this with the words of John. Let's take it seriously, guys. He that believeth on the Son of Man hath everlasting life. He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life. And he that believeth not the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. Why? Remember what Jesus said up here. He says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned. What's that word there? Already. God bless you guys. I love you. This is Shock. Let's take it serious. There's nothing more serious than eternity and where you're going to spend it.